So the Fulbright Canada Mitacs Globalink program started 3 years ago. So this is the third competition, the third application period for which this particular joint program is running. And this program came about basically for allowing US undergraduate students to take part in this very interesting and very competitive program that allows undergraduate students to do undergraduate internships at Canadian institutions during the summer months. This is a program that Mitacs has been running with other countries, and alongside Fulbright Canada has entered the US market for allowing US undergraduate students to get a chance to have access to relevant internships in Canada. So this slide, and because most of you had probably heard about Fulbright, this slide aims to talk a bit about what is Mitacs. And I think Fiona will be in a much better position to talk about Mitacs than I am. So Fiona, I would like to invite you to step in and talk a bit about what is Mitacs for undergraduate US students to get a clear sense of what Mitacs is all about.
Certainly, thank you. So Mitacs is a not-for-profit organization based in Canada. And for the last just over 20 years, we've been organizing and designing and delivering research and training programs for mainly for graduate students and postdoctoral fellows, and also more recently to senior undergraduate students as well. We work with more than 100 post-secondary institutions across Canada, and as well as over, I think, about 6,000 companies as well. So our main activity within Canada is to support innovation through industry and academic collaborations. And we began that program in 2003. And since then, I think we're on target to deliver about 15,000 of these types of research internships within Canada. And since 2009, we've had an international component, which is our Globalink program, which is really what we're here to talk to you about today. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you so much, Fiona. So just as a adding to what Fiona said, although this is only the third edition of the program with US undergraduate, this program has already gained a lot of traction with US applicants. So we have already built a lot of bridges between Fulbright Canada and Mitacs and US institutions, and we can say that this program, although it's very new, is already a success with US undergraduate students. So, in terms of what is the program about and which are the main criteria for undertaking this program? So, all candidates need to have the ability to come to Canada for 10 to 12 weeks. But the good thing is that this takes place during the summer. So, in most cases, you won't have classes. So, from roughly May to October, so between these months, you can undertake your internship during a period that can vary between 10 to 12 weeks. This program is very comprehensive, so you can see that there are projects that are aiming at all fields of knowledge. This is not a program specifically designed for a particular field. It encompasses opportunities for students from many different fields. The idea is that when you come to Canada, you are working alongside a supervisor in a Canadian at a Canadian institution, and you will be involved in the research project that person is undertaking. We can say that although the first edition of the program was severely affected by COVID, last year we were able to actually engage in placements between US students and Canadian professors or professors in Canada. And the overall idea is that US students are very competitive and very skilled in their fields of expertise. Students will be also given the opportunity to take part in other activities. Obviously, this is something that it's depending on the public health guidelines at the time, but during a normal year, students would also have access to other activities that would be aligned with the Globalink program. So like I mentioned, this program is open to all fields of knowledge. So you can be a student from science, engineering, mathematics, humanities, social sciences, and eventually other fields that may not be listed here. And you could see that there would be projects that could be applicable to your field of interest. Like Fiona said, this is a program that has a lot of opportunities. There's a large amount of projects available every year. And once you make it past the first round, you are then able to select the projects that you would like to be considered for. And at that point, you will see that there's a huge variety of opportunities that are available to you. In terms of the eligibility, we try to keep the program as simple as possible. So the eligibility conditions are very straightforward. They do require that all candidates have US citizenship and are studying at an accredited university located in the US. You can also have dual Canadian and US citizenship, but once again, you need to be studying in the US. You need to have at least one semester remaining from your programs after the internship takes place. So in here, we mentioned fall 2022, because since this is a summer internship, we anticipate that you will need to go back to school during the fall term. If you are already in your last year, you are not eligible to apply. And we also don't encourage first-year students to apply, because we anticipate that you don't yet have enough experience at the higher institution for undertaking an internship at that time. So our recommendation is that students in their third year from a four-year program or in the fourth year of a five-year program would be the strongest candidates for a program like this. The GPA needs to be competitive. And by competitive, obviously this varies from year to year. But last year we received a large amount of applications from students with very high GPAs. So we anticipate that if the GPA is lower than 3.2, your application may not be very competitive. Once again, this may vary, but this was our experience from last year. You will need to be fully available to take part in the internship for 10 to 12 weeks. So you need to make the necessary arrangements to be in Canada for that period of time. So it's consecutive. You're not supposed to go back and forth. It's a consecutive period of time in Canada. You need to be proficient in English. And eventually you need to be proficient in French should you be interested in undertaking an internship at a French-speaking institution with a French-speaking supervisor or a project that requires French proficiency. Applications should come in no later than October 15. They are currently open. And we have five more days so until October 20 to receive the two references that are required for the application. The benefits of this program, as you have probably anticipated by now, is that you will have the opportunity to do an international internship. So you will have the opportunity to enhance your network of contacts, to establish connections that might be helpful in case you would like to pursue graduate studies in Canada, to get to know colleagues from different parts of the world, since in Canada there's a lot of multiculturalism present in our universities. You will have access to Canadian top research facilities, and obviously you will have a grant to support you in your time in Canada. So the grant is $7,800 Canadian that would assist you to stay in Canada and be able to cover most or all of your expenses. The other added benefit is that because the Globalink is not a Fulbright program, it does not prevent you from applying for a Fulbright graduate student program afterwards, for example. So in this part, I would like to once again invite Fiona to lead the way. Basically, we will be talking a bit about the Globalink internships and what is available to students and the type of projects that you can expect.
Great, thank you. So in terms of the internship cohort, each year we bring in about, or accept into the program, anywhere between 1,000 to 1,100 students from around the world. So you are in Canada as part of a cohort. So you can arrive anytime as early as the beginning of May and end your internship as late as October, at the end of October. So during that time, not only will you be able to network and make connections with Canadian students, but also the cohort of students from around the world who will also be participating in the program. We have this year almost 3,000 projects that have been submitted by Canadian professors, and they're available, and you can see them actually on our website, the number of projects on the Globalink website. And this year so far, we've received actually a record amount of applications, of about 25,000 applications, which is not insignificant. And at the end of the day, we'll probably place around about 1,100 students who we anticipate will be able to come to Canada in person in the summertime.
Yes. So I think the next slide. Okay, so the next slide is about the timeline. So the way that the competition works is pretty straightforward. So until October 15, you will be able to submit your application for the program. So this first step is done via the Fulbright website. And for anyone that is not yet sure where they need to start applying, please write to info@fulbright.ca and we will make sure that you're applying in the right section of the website. Like I said, you have 5 more days for your references to submit your reference letters. And between October 20th and early November, we will need basically to make decisions on which are the candidates that will move on to the second round, where they will be invited to start selecting projects. So for the ones that already asked us if they need to select projects during this first application stage, you don't. You are not expected to select projects at this point. You can definitely look into the projects just to get an idea of which type of projects are available, but there is no selection done at this point. Selections will be done once you receive confirmation that you made it the second round, which should take place around November. In February, there will be reviews of all the applications and the projects. There will be a need to match the students with the projects and with the professors that are leading those projects. And once that is done, then the student will receive a confirmation that they were in fact selected to take part in the Globalink program. Fiona, I don't know if there's anything else that you would like to add during the regarding the timeline.
No, I just wanted to reiterate that the projects, you can see the projects that are available on the Globalink website, and that you will be invited to select anywhere between 3 and 7 projects across a minimum of 3 provinces in Canada. Having had the opportunity to take a little peek at the projects, maybe when you're writing your CV or resume, maybe you want to make sure that you can highlight what skills that you can bring to the projects that you're really interested in. So when you go into the matchmaking process, the professors who are evaluating which student they'd like to work with next summer, they can have a good, it's really clear for them to see that you will be a good fit for the project. Quite often the professors will also set up an interview as well, just to make sure that you're a good fit for the project. So I think those are the extra tips I can offer there.
Yeah, so exactly. And following the pieces of the application, not only the personal statement. So the pieces that you need to provide are pretty straightforward. So the application has an online form that you need to complete in full, which is pretty straightforward. You will need to provide the transcripts for the program that you're attending. So the transcripts so far, a current CV. So just make sure that your CV is up to date and uploaded. 2 references. So the way that the reference works is you will need to provide the names and emails of the people that you want them to be your references, and then they will receive an email with access to an online form where they will be able to provide, either upload the letter of recommendation, or also add additional comments and basically fill out a small questionnaire about your abilities as a suitable student for a program like this. Finally, the personal statement, for which I have additional hints in the next slide. So the personal statement is a document that should not take more than 2 pages, where you will be discussing why, or you will be making a case on why you should be selected for this program. So what are the things that you would hope to achieve during your stay in Canada? The type of experiences that you may have that will be a good fit for the program, or that show that you're prepared to undertake an international experience. Highlights and opportunities or experiences that you have had that will show that you are that you easily adjust to new realities or new cultural settings, your willingness to share and learn from other people, prior research experience, and obviously if you have achievements that are worth mentioning, please do so that the person reading your personal statement can have a full picture of the main accomplishments that you have so far. So the personal statement, there's no need to go into the detail of the type of project that you want to do. It's more a case on why you are a good fit for the program, why you are prepared to undertake a program like this, and what would be the added benefits that undertaking a program like this would bring to you. In terms of the CV, CV needs to be a concise document, so no more than 2 pages. The CV basically follows the traditional model. You would highlight your education, your work, if that's the case, volunteer experience, any scholarships or awards that you have received, relevant achievements, interests, and language skills. In terms of the references, you only need 2. So we do recommend that the references are either professors that know you from an academic setting, or people that have worked with you under supervisory role in research projects, for example. So they don't need to be a professor from a specific course. They can be someone that, for example, have supervised you during a research project. Usually we are not very interested in professional references. So let's imagine that you have worked in a store or something. So those are not the references that we are looking for. We are looking for references that will be able to speak highly about your ability to conduct this project. Okay. Make sure that they are aware that October 20th is the deadline to submit the reference. And also, please understand that they will only receive an email asking for the reference after you submitted your part of the application. So first, you need to submit your part of the application, and you can do that at any point between now and October 15. And the references, like I said, are all provided directly from the referee to us. Okay, so they will not be giving you any letter of recommendation for you to send us. So the review, like I mentioned, this program is very competitive. We have received applications from a large number of students that have very remarkable academic record. Please be sure to highlight and to shine a very bright light into your main achievements so that the reviewers don't miss it. You will be evaluated on a series of factors like your academic record, your personal statement, the skills and interests that you are reflecting in your personal statement and in your CV, and very importantly, your letters of recommendation. So please be sure to select recommenders that are able to speak highly about your abilities as students, as researchers, so that the reviewers can have a really compelling picture of why they should select you. The matching process. Once again, I would ask Fiona to walk us through the matching process, because she is much more knowledgeable than we are here at Fulbright. So Fiona, if you can shed some light on the matching process.
Certainly. So I guess to start off, at the first phase is really having the Canadian professors submit projects at the universities across Canada, and they all those projects are reviewed, and then they're put up on the website. So they're reviewed to make sure that the level is appropriate, and the professor's not just trying to get someone to come and make coffee for them over summer. It's going to be a good valid research project for a student to come and work on. After the initial review by Fulbright, they then give Mitacs the list of successful students, and then Mitacs invites the students to submit their preferences for their projects on our online platform. There is an opportunity to rank the projects that you're interested in, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, etc. And then the professors who view the applications, they also rank the students, and then there's an opportunity for like the mutually ranked top applicants with the professors to have an interview and confirm that it is a good match for the project to take place next summer. So in terms of, I can see there's a couple of questions in the chat. So you can actually look at the projects and filter by social sciences and humanities. There are projects across all academic disciplines that are available to apply to. So that's a good question.
Yeah, we will be sharing. So tomorrow we will be sharing the recording, and in the email, we will be including the link where you can see all the projects.
Oh, perfect. Yeah, so, that would probably help respond exactly. to some of those, the questions about the types of projects. But exactly. there are many to choose from, for sure.
Yeah. So everyone that registered will have access to the list of projects. And once again, you don't need to select projects at this first stage. It's just for you to have an idea of what's available. Yeah. Okay. So moving on. So one thing that it's very curious to see is the impact that this program already had in with U.S. students. So this past competition, there was actually one U.S. student that was featured in Canadian television because her project was broadcasted alongside the professor in Canada. It was a project, if I'm not mistaken, with related to ticks. So this was something that was very curious. So the student was basically interviewed live in television. So as you can see, this is a program that it's very big in Canada, and for which it will definitely make a big impact in everyone that has the opportunity to complete this Globalink internship. So just before moving into the questions, let me just share something with you that I think will be helpful just for you to have an idea. So in here, you are seeing an example of a reference from the Globalink program. So like I said, your professors will not be giving you reference letters directly. What they will need to do is go into this website that you are currently seeing, and for which this is just an example of the person that is featured there, where the professor basically needs to state the name and the email and the institution of the student. Okay, so this is the student, and then their information, name, address, email, phone, a relationship to the applicant, how long do they know the applicant, in which capacity have they known the applicant, then rank in this table different elements, academic performance, intellectual ability, so on. I'm not going to go through each element. Upload a letter if they have it. In some cases, they may not have it. We would recommend that everyone has a letter of recommendation. That would be really helpful, because this is a mandatory field. If they don't have one, they need to upload something. So it can be a blank document just to make it work. Because they might just have something to add in additional comments and not have a formal reference letter. Once everything is done, they will submit it, and this is basically the application, okay? So just for the sake of clarity, for you to apply for the Globalink program, you come to undergraduate students, and once again, I will be sending this on the email tomorrow, Globalink program. And in here, you are able to read about the program. You have different tabs here just to give you a bit more information on elements. So all of these elements we have talked about during the presentation. You have application instructions here. So the application is pretty straightforward. Some guidelines for the personal statement, and the actual application is here, in Apply Now. So you will start by ticking all these boxes so that we are sure that you are actually able to undertake the program. And then once you press next, these different fields will come up: biographical data, academic history, language, supporting documents, and confirmation. Because this requires to fill out this information to move on to the next level, I'm not going to go and fill out this, but the logic is that once you start filling out, you can either save it or you can move on to the next. I can tell you right away that if you have all the elements beside you, so if you have your transcripts, the CV, and your personal statement, you can fill out this in 15 to 20 minutes max. So moving on to our presentation, and now talking a bit about any questions that you have indicated. So just before starting with the questions, if you want to get in touch with us, you can also reach out to the Globalink at Fulbright.ca. Or if you don't remember this email, probably it's easier for just to remember info@fulbright.ca, which is also another way to contact us. So moving on to the questions that you have included here in our Q&A box. Let's see what you have here. So someone says, what makes a candidate stand out? I will probably give you some hints on what we have been seeing so far, and then Fiona can probably add to what I'm saying. So, like I said, this is a very competitive program. Definitely having a strong academic record is very helpful. I won't say it otherwise. This is a program that it's at undergraduate level. Most candidates will not have a lot of experience. So the thing that most of you will have to show is your academic record. And that's one of the things that will impact a lot in the application. However, your personal statement and your reference letters are also a big chunk of how decisions are made with this program. If you have reference letters that shine a very bright light on you as a student, as someone that is interested in a particular field, that have done already relevant work in that field, that will be very, very helpful for the application. Your personal statement also is another key component. So if you have experiences volunteering for specific organizations that might be relevant for the sake of this program, or to make us understand more about yourself, definitely address those elements and make sure that you are in your project, in your personal statement, also shining some light on why coming to Canada will be helpful for you, and how ready you are to undertake an international experience if that's the first time that you're doing it. I don't know if there's anything else that you would like to add, Fiona, in this section. What makes a candidate stand out?
No, I don't have anything to add, actually. I think you've covered everything off really nicely there, all the key points.
Yeah. Okay. So the other question that we have, what will make for a strong reference letter of recommendation? Is there anything my reference should focus while writing it? So I already addressed a bit this during the presentation and the question before this one. I would just say that make sure that you choose references that are really comfortable writing about you. In some cases, what we notice is that some references seem to be either not knowledgeable enough or seem to be a bit shy when they are writing, because they don't actually say much about the candidate. So, or they say very vague elements about the candidate, being a good student, being very cooperative during classes and interested, but they don't go into specific examples. Okay, so basically where I'm getting at is try to find references that can provide examples on why you have good research skills, why you are a very talented student. Okay, so examples are much more important than just general wording about how good of a student someone is. Ellie is asking, is any housing travel included? Would housing be on university campus, or would be necessary to sublease? So Ellie, I will answer a part of this question, and then I will pass on to Fiona for probably a bit more details on how this is handled directly with university. So all of you, if selected, will receive the Globalink grant. That grant is supposed to offset the costs of staying in Canada. Okay, so you need to use that grant for your travel needs, for your housing needs, for transportation, from accommodation, okay? So all of those things need to be paid through the grant, okay? Obviously, that's the logic of the grant. We have an amount that should be more than enough to cover all your expenses. In regarding to housing, I would ask Fiona to probably talk a bit about this. I don't have specific examples to give you, because so far this program with US students has only taken place online because of COVID. So I'm not entirely sure what happens exactly when you are all in Canada.
Thank you. So in terms of the accommodation, Mitacs helps provide like introductions and links to the on-campus accommodations. Usually it's fairly easy to get on-campus accommodations during the summer break because most of the regular students are away. So a lot of the Globalink students do choose to stay on campus, and Mitacs helps provide leads in terms of how to get in touch with the on-campus accommodation office. Otherwise, if preferred, students are also welcome to find accommodation off campus as well. And we provide links. It's kind of more self-generated, your accommodation in Canada, because everyone has their own preferences about where they would like to be housed during that time.
Okay. I guess overall what we are trying to say is that if you are selected, I'm pretty sure that you will find the necessary housing that you will need to be in Canada. So the probably the most difficult part is just being selected. The rest of it will come naturally. Alexander is asking, do you have advice for selecting a project? So Alexander, all I can say about that is that because you will need to go through a matching process, you should definitely select projects for which you feel that you will be able to bring added value. So projects that relate to your field of, to your academics, to your field of interest, to the things that eventually you have been doing so far. Definitely you need to think it also from the perspective of the professor. So when he's selecting a student, he will probably be looking for a student that can already feel a bit comfortable doing whatever the project is about. So that's something to keep in mind. I don't know if there's anything else, Fiona, that you would like to add on advices on how to select projects.
No, except you are able to and encouraged to choose more than one project. You can choose a minimum of three projects. And just to reiterate, I would, if it was me, I would pick projects that are in my field of interest and where I want to go with my research career and where I feel I can bring some value to the project. We have some interesting impact stories on our webs, on the Mitacs website as well, that can show a little bit about projects that have taken place in the past, and some of the students talk a little bit about sort of how the project applies to their experience. So perhaps Paulo, we could include that in the link, that link with the email to the participants.
Yeah,
for the applicants tomorrow.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So another question is, if accepted to the second round, is there a possibility that someone is not placed? So the second round basically enables you to select projects and go into the matching stage. So there is a possibility that you won't be matched. Okay, so the second stage just means that now you are able to select projects, but you still need to go through the matching process so that You need to find a suitable supervisor that is interested in working with you. So I guess we still have also some questions in the chat box. So I will be going back and forth between the Q&A and chat box. Jaiseline is asking if a student that has participated virtually this past summer can apply again for in-person. So Jaiseline, we are trying to give this opportunity to as many students as possible. So if you have participated in one of the editions, we would likely feel more tempted to give the opportunity to new students that haven't yet had the opportunity to participate in the Globalink project program. So another question, if selected, will students be able to get involved in on-campus community activities during their stay in Canada? So Fiona, do you want to take the lead on this one? I know that there are parallel activities.
Certainly, yeah. So so each student that's selected, they will have, will they be assigned a what we call a Globalink mentor, who's usually a graduate student based on campus of the where the project is taking place. So for starters, that the mentors will be like your guide to help you know, explore campus and get to know where your lab is and everything else, as well as taking care of some of the, I guess, social aspects and organizing get-togethers with people in your cohort and people in the city that you're based in. The other activities that we provide as part of the program are, we have professional skills training sessions. So those training sessions have been developed sort of in tangent with our domestic program, whereby students have the opportunity to take part in project management training, networking, presentation skills, lots of kind of really hands-on things that can apply both to your research experience and also outside of the research environment in an industrial environment when you enter the workforce. And also we do have other networking opportunities as well that are put on throughout the course of the summer. So that could be a meet and greet with different industry partners in Canada, different universities, the Mitacs team who put on the, you know, the people that put the work into to make the program happen, and other, if there's in the past when there's been interesting like conferences or other activities, we do a lot of sort of social networking community activities in addition to the research component, which is very important.
Mm. Okay, so I'm gonna answer the last question in the Q&A, and then I will move on to the chat. So just that we are fully aware of where I'm answering questions. Does having research experience help with stand out positively? This was Ranim. Definitely. So if you already have research experience, do make sure that you're highlighting that in your personal statement, because definitely that will be valuable to know. So now moving on to the chat box, let's see if we have different questions than the ones that we already replied. So do we just need to make sure that we have a valid passport by the time the program would occur? So I think that for you to come to Canada, Emily and everyone else, I think you need to have a valid passport. Definitely you need to have a valid passport, and you need to have a passport that it's valid after the program finishes. So that will allow immigration to know that your passport is good when you're supposed to leave the country. What is the recommended length for the personal statement? So, Julia, most people will write their personal statement in one page, and we don't recommend that it's too long. By too long, I mean more than one page and a half, because obviously people are supposed to read it from start to end, and if it's too long, then probably that will create some distractions, because people still have a lot of other personal statements to read. So I would definitely say keep it to one page, Arial 12, a single space, something like that. Mary, if a student is declined this year and eligible again, I guess next year, would he or she be permitted to apply again? Yeah, as long as you're eligible, you can reapply if you're not successful. You're also asking what kind of projects are available. So we will share the link and you will be able to see them. Is the deadline for references October 20 or September 30? So it's October 20. So the September 30 was a mistake that was sent out on one of our emails, because that was the deadline for last year. So we missed that, and we indicated September when it's in fact October 20. Yes. So just for sake of clarity, it's 5 days after the deadline. The deadline is October 15, so references by October 20. Can a student who participate in the program we already answered the question of matching students. So Mary is asking, Fulbright prioritizes students that can act as cultural ambassadors. How important is this quality to the selection? Should the applicant and letters highlight this quality? So you can give examples, for your personal statement, of situations where you have done, where you have been abroad and you have experienced contact with people from other countries, and you had to introduce them to the reality in your community or in your university. So all of these things is what we mean by cultural ambassadors. Obviously, you don't need to have an extensive experience with dealing with people from other countries, but the fact that you're able to speak highly about your home university, to let people from other countries know what is being done there in your field of expertise, all of those things can definitely shine a bright light on your ability to be a cultural ambassador. Rachel is asking, would students who have finished their second year be competitive candidates? Yeah, for sure. Students that have finished their second year can also be competitive candidates. That's fine. Tiago is asking, the personal statement is a maximum of 2 pages, but on the website it says 1. So if it's 2 pages, we are not going to disqualify you because of that. But as I mentioned before, keep it to 1 page. Okay. Should the CV also be 1 page? If you can compact everything in 1 page, that's fine. If you need to go up to 2, we would also accept it. So I guess it all depends on how much information you want to include in your CV. And please do include relevant information. So although we find that it may be interesting for us to know that you have work experience, it's much more important for us that you, for example, talk about volunteer activities that are relevant than, for example, summer jobs in stores or things of that sort that don't actually have to do with the project or with the program. So with all of this, I think that we have covered all of the questions that were mentioned here. I don't think we have any other questions. Nope, we covered them all. So, Fiona, is there anything else that you would like to add as a closing statement for this presentation?
No, nothing in particular. Just thank you all for your interest in the program, and good luck with the application process. Yeah. And hope to see you in Canada next summer.
Yeah. So from our end, this is the presentation that we have planned for you today. If you have questions, which probably will appear as you progress through the application, please make sure to write to globalink@fulbright.ca. We will try to answer them as quick as possible. Tomorrow, you will be receiving a link, an email with a link for the presentation, with links for where you can have a perspective on the projects that are available. And also, that will be the email that you can answer back in case you have other questions during the application stage. So once again, thank you so much for taking the time to assist this presentation. Good luck if you're considering applying. If that's not something that you will be doing this year, but consider probably next year, we will announce any new additions that will follow. So every year around September, that's when the competition is supposed to open, if the competition is running. So if this is not the year for you to apply, then definitely keep an eye out for our website. And if that's something that you want to do in the near future, we'll be happy to help. So thank you so much and enjoy the rest of the week.